Hi, and welcome to episode 4 of Brainstorm, Saskatchewan's only skeptical podcast where we talk about current events, religion, politics, and science in a somewhat intelligent manner. This episode was recorded on January 11th, 2014, and tonight Lana, Mike, Rene, and I will be talking about a few topics I found in the news, a TED talk on economic disparity, the Friendly Atheist's video of predictions for 2014, vitamins, and the documentary Christ Core. This is going to be a three-part episode, so here you go with part one. But I temple my space and invoke the siren song and sign the death warrant. This is what has been wrought for 30 paces of silver. The tongues of men and angels bought by a beloved betrayer. And we're live.
So I guess our first topic is this NFL player that was fired because of his stance on same-sex marriage.
What stance is that?
He was pro same-sex marriage. He was quite outspoken about it, and well, he figures he got fired. He doesn't have any evidence to that necessarily. He figures he was fired because of his stance on same-sex marriage.
Not that surprising.
No, not really.
Given that sports is a difficult place, I think, to be supportive of gay rights, and especially difficult to be open as gay, I think, in professional sports generally. So it's the locker room kind of mentality there, I guess, where everyone must not deviate from the norm.
What I thought was interesting about it was he talked to, I guess, the owners, and they both gave him the go-ahead to talk about this stuff, like to be outspoken. And except for his special teams coach, who was rabidly anti-homosexual in the locker room and whatnot, and then he eventually did just get fired. I thought it was the opposite of the Duck Dynasty situation.
What's that? Yeah. Thank goodness I don't know anything really about Duck Dynasty.
Well, the Duck Dynasty thing is the guy said that homosexuality was like bestiality or pedophilia, and then A&E fired him.
He said a number of things, including some anti-homosexual statements and some rather odd statements about how happy the blacks were back before Jim Crow and right. All of that.
Wow. The only thing is, it's like I watch a show and this will set me up to get roasted, but I actually was entertained by it. I mean, it wasn't a great show, but it was entertaining. But the problem with that is Phil Robertson is... Oh, let's face facts. The guy is the epitome of redneck. Like, he's got like a grade 8 education. If he didn't luck out with this duck call, he'd be just another boob in the backwoods.
I've actually heard that he has a master's degree.
No, that's his son. That's his son that does. His son, he invented the duck call that made them their first million. And then his son went ahead and got his master's degree. And then exponentially made it bigger, which made the Duck Dynasty empire with, you know, the Duck Dynasty cookbooks and underwear and whatever else they got their name on.
Everything. Yeah.
But, you know, like, I mean, ultimately, with the big controversy with this Duck Dynasty, I think it's just the fact that he is just a redneck, and for whatever reason, I think they baited him in the GQ interview a bit. And then he started shooting his mouth off, and it just proved that, yeah, he's still...
Well, I don't know the context, because in a sense, homosexuality is like bestiality or pedophilia in the sense that it's something you're born with. I mean, you either are attracted to children or you aren't. It's not something you learn. So, I mean, there's definite comparison there.
Yeah.
It's just there's a definite difference when it comes to morality. Obviously, homosexuality has nothing to do with morality.
Yeah, well,
it's just a preference.
He's equating it as sin is sin is sin. It's not biblical and yada, 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 yada. Like, all the usual...
Garbage,
yeah. Like, he also came out saying that just recently that, you know, because he married his wife, however long they've been married, they married when she was quite young, is, you know, marry your girls quite young so then you can... mold them the way you want them.
Like, yeah, that was
so
like
that
sermons.
They will pick your ducks. Marry them at 15 or 16 so that they will pick your ducks for you. If you wait until they're 20, they're not going to pick your ducks.
Yeah, exactly. And it's like, yeah. It's like, I'm like, I was
pick
entertained.
Your ducks?
which yeah. would, I think, mean pick the feathers out of them.
Yeah.
Oh, I see.
Because
I see.
Once they get to a certain age, then they think for themselves. And that's just.
And they went to school where none of their friends are picking feathers out of ducks.
Yeah.
So I don't actually buy his argument that much. If you grew up in a family in a town where that was a thing, then maybe you would adjust to that kind of lifestyle. But anyways, I think the thing with the Phil Robertson situation is how rare it is, how rare it is to have a situation where somebody can get fired from their job for being mildly outspoken about homosexuality. Like, honestly, that goes right. on in all yeah. kinds of places in across North America. And people do generally not get fired for that. It was just because he was in media that yeah. that happened. Whereas the other, getting back to the original story, as I think it's probably a lot more common that people are going to get fired for either being gay or being supportive of being gay in the culture that we're in now. Now, there's a lot of Christians.
Or the U.S.
That yes. And in the U.S., there's a lot of people that would argue this, that, you know, what's the balance? How many people would get fired for being pro gay marriage and gay rights, and how many people would get fired for being against it?
I'd say definitely you're probably going to get more who are fired for being more pro same-sex.
So.
In the U.S., possibly, yeah.
Yeah, in Canada, it would be much different. There would be some protections. So. You might get in trouble with your HR department if you were going around saying, you know, things. But in the States right now, there's most states don't have much protection for that sort of thing.
I mean, up here it's a different thing because it's already legalized. It's yeah. a non-debate. But that's down right. in the States, it's still going, it's state by state.
For some reason.
And some of them are trying to backpedal it, which is like, what was that one? Was it Utah?
It could be, yeah.
Where they tried to reverse the same-sex ruling, and then the judge went, no. No, that's not going to happen.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, that sounds familiar.
I mean, the only other thing that popped up when I briefly read that article is that I was kind of wondering if, and it might have been just the case that his special teams coaches didn't like him because he's so pro, you know,
right,
same-sex marriage or whatever. But I'm wondering sometimes, do they have a clause? Because sometimes they have to sign these kind of clauses.
Right.
He can't, and there might have been a political clause in his contract as well.
Yeah, I think because he said in this article anyway that he checked with the legal department and he talked to the owner and everybody gave him the go ahead, but ultimately this one bigot was really outspoken and really came down on him a lot. And then
yeah, but I wouldn't think with just one guy could get you fired off a team.
It depends. I think like certain coaches have a lot of power.
Yeah, but I don't think. Well, I don't know how the power structure is, but I don't think a special team coordinator can get one guy fired.
Well, when that guy is a punter.
I guess, yeah. I guess if...
I think he could easily do it.
Yeah.
But, I mean, he never once accused anybody of squashing his freedom of speech. He said, this is possibly the reason I got fired. I don't know for sure, but...
Funny thing, it was with the freedom of speech thing. I don't think it was ever Phil Robertson that was saying that.
No, that's true.
That was just, you know...
Those people who supported him.
His defenders.
Yeah. Well, they with their own agenda, you know, like Bobby Jindal and Sarah Palin and, you know.
Right.
Like, Bristol Palin.
Yeah. Like, I'm going to get political advice from the Palins. Right.
It's rather people do, though.
Yeah. It's kind of scary.
Odd.
Yeah. I don't think I'd take any advice whatsoever from, you know, Sarah Palin.
No. I mean, if you look at her credentials, she served, what, half a term and then made a run at being vice president?
The only reason she's famous is because John McCain friggin' tagged her.
Credentials is like a political, you know, expert maybe.
Yeah.
But credentials is an actual human being that's capable of a reason. She doesn't have any of those.
Right. Zero.
Yeah. Sorry.
Yeah. Her grasp of geography is awesome. I can see Russia from my house. I don't know. The only thing I find funny is because I've watched it before. Like Phil Robertson came out and they fired him or sanctioned him or whatever.
Yeah, he's got his job back now, I guess. So
whatever. Whatever. Like, I mean, the only thing is that you have down in the States, especially there, there's all this talk about freedom of speech and stuff like that. And it's like you have the right to say it, but I don't know. There seems to be a trend where when people step over the line, fire them. which I don't know if that's the right way to do it. Cause like a few years ago, Don Imus, big shock jock down there, said some stupid stuff about, was it the black basketball? He got roasted. And like, the thing was, is should he be criticized for saying stupid stuff like that? Absolutely. But I don't know if it's a good way if, you know, when you say something stupid to then get fired for it, I don't know if that's a good precedent to set, you know, like, I mean, you look at say Bill Maher after 9/11, he got fired for the stuff he said. And it's like, you should be open to criticism, but you shouldn't necessarily get fired unless you say something like extremely.
Well, I think it's a different situation when you're actually in the media and like you're in the public spotlight versus your average citizen. Right. Like,
then again, today's modern world, everyone's kind of in the media.
That's like, true. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, exactly. Everybody is kind of.
And you can be caught on
Twitter.
Twitter.
If you say something stupid on Twitter and that blows up and you get a whole bunch of people retweeting that and pointing out what a dumbass you are, that can get big pretty fast.
That's true. That's right. I mean, the irony of it is, you get retweeted and obviously it's you that said it. And then how many people, the trolls on the comments section on YouTube.
And then sometimes Secret Service comes to visit you because you said something really stupid.
Right. That would be no good.
Yeah.
Yeah. You mean like Ted Nugent?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Well, there was multiple times, like after the election and during the election, where people were saying very ignorant things about Obama and how somebody should shoot him or somebody, like, how stupid are you to
Yeah, you tweet know the NSA like is watching you.
Yeah.
I mean, and that's just what I mean. Like, he should be the freedom of speech. And it was pointed out on MSNBC one night, was they were talking about the freedom of speech, and it doesn't guarantee you can say stupid shit.
No.
With impunity.
Yeah, with impunity. It just guarantees you can be critical of the government without being arrested for it.
Well, and the government doesn't squash your freedom to say whatever stupid bullshit you want.
Yeah, like, I mean, I question on whether, you know, you say something stupid, like, as a media personality, and whether you should be fired or not.
Right.
But ultimately, most of those they're still corporations, privately owned, whether they have stockholders or whatever. But that's their business decision to fire you. Yes. And they should be able to do that.
Absolutely.
That's the thing. Freedom of speech only guarantees that you're not going to be suppressed.
Yeah.
You know, that your whatever points you're making, the speech you're making isn't going to be entirely suppressed, you know, by the government.
Yeah.
But yeah, it has nothing to do with whether a private organization is allowed to fire you.
Yeah.
Nothing at all.
No, like, I mean, I question whether they should be dealt that way. I mean, they should be totally open for criticism because, like, the stuff Phil Robertson said was kind of like, really? Even though there's a majority of Americans, or I don't know how true it is, but
it seems like.
Lawrence O'Donnell said that, you know, when last polled, up to 45% of the American public believe along the same lines as Phil Robertson, you know, so.
If not a majority, there's a pretty big cross section of America that would generally agree with him. I think that's a fair statement. A sizable cross section.
Yeah, but we're discussing free speech in relation to someone saying that homosexuality is okay. I mean, it's like saying liking ice cream, or, you know, vanilla ice cream more than chocolate ice cream is okay.
You know, and they get
fired from their job.
You know,
and it's a mere preference.
Yeah. Meanwhile, we're having this discussion. Meanwhile, it really doesn't matter.
No, it shouldn't matter.
It's not an issue.
It's just a preference.
Yeah, it's not an issue. Like it's a stupid debate.
Not like eating vanilla ice cream is immoral, and means that you shouldn't have any. You know, if you like vanilla ice cream. And I like chocolate ice cream. You shouldn't be allowed to eat ice cream at all. Because that's disgusting, man.
Yeah.
You know, that's the kind of bullshit we're dealing with here. You can find a
Bible verse to back that up.
Yeah. That's right.
I don't see what everybody's getting hung up over.
Well, that's just it.
It was
a stupid statement that has just blown up to this bigger issue that I think... For most people, well, I shouldn't say most because obviously there is the majority, but anyone that thinks for a second, it's a non-issue. It's just kind of like, whatever. Just
yeah,
another
that's right.
dumbass saying something stupid.
Yeah. Whether someone's homosexual is really none of my business.
No.
Exactly.
Just like their favorite ice cream flavor. I mean, I suppose I'll ask them if I'm interested in having sex with them, but beyond that, I don't give a shit.
Yeah.
Or sharing ice cream.
Or sharing ice cream, exactly. Yeah. What flavor would you like?
Yeah. I like vanilla. You sick, disgusting pervert. What are you thinking?
You're going to burn in hell. No. Mm-hmm. No, it makes no sense.
Yeah.
It just seems like in this more modern age of Facebook and Twitter and every other social feed, it just seems every little blurb just gets exploded. Like just
things have the potential, amazing potential, to go from just an idea or a funny statement or something and just to go huge.
Yeah.
And it's hard to predict which ones will do that and which ones won't. And I found it very interesting, especially through the last election in the States, to watch some of the Twitter feeds. And I was on there quite a lot. Hmm. And it's social media is crazy.
Well, there's also, and I've watched, because like with the new YouTube thing, like this is kind of going a little off topic, but they were talking about the commentating and how they're rewriting their algorithms for almost editing it. And there is that element of, you know, because of anonymity and whatever else, things go viral. A lot of people talk about it, but they comment on the stupidest thing because they're hidden behind,
right,
you know, Twitter handles or YouTube, mm-hmm. you know, handles. And it's just stupid.
Yeah, it can give ignorant people the bravery to say really ignorant things that they maybe wouldn't say in person.
Yeah.
That's like some of the female atheists on YouTube have to block the comments on their pages because they get some of the most insane comments. Mm-hmm. Like, it's unbelievable.
Well, anonymity is the reason 12-year-old racists are teabagging you on Call of Duty or something. You
know? Right.
While screaming at you. So they can. I mean, it's their parents won't hear about it because who the hell is, right. you know, Bunny Raper 15? Like.
Yeah. Well, I'm not as active on Twitter now, but when I was, I didn't post a picture on there. Why on earth would I post a picture of myself so that people can sit there and try to nitpick something when they run out of anything constructive to say toward an argument? They're just going to say something about, you're an ugly cow. That's the, you know, somewhat for everybody, but especially for women, that's the go-to thing.
Yeah, it seems to.
You're a fat, ugly cow. So
therefore,
your opinion is invalid.
What? It doesn't matter that she's 10 times smarter than you.
Yeah, non sequitur.
Yeah, that's right. Ad hominem.
But I mean, I think it still feeds into the same thing where just something as stupid is said and it just goes viral and just explodes into, and everyone brings in their own little agendas.
Hi, just a quick break to remind everyone to follow us on Twitter at BrainstormPod and to like us on the Facebook page Brainstorm Podcast. Episodes are available on iTunes and Stitcher Radio. Remember to give us a rating and write a review, as both improve the show's reach. It actually costs a bit to produce a podcast too, so any donations are more than welcome. Just click the donate button on our WordPress page, brainstormpodcastblog.wordpress.com.
About how they broke the internet. I don't know if you guys read that.
Broke the internet?
Yeah, basically.
Define broke.
Well, basically he's saying that these news companies have turned into pages that just want more hits. They don't give a shit about responsible journalism. They need more hits. They need more hits. Say they put out articles and then they get hits. And then when it turns out to be false, they put out an article apologizing for it and they get hits. And it's all about the fucking, the publicity, basically. Like, in truth in journalism doesn't mean anything anymore.
And that's not a completely new phenomenon, because you can say that of network news and their ratings also. But with the, certainly with website phenomenon, it's so much easier to look at, you know, in the first 2 hours something's posted or 24 hours something's posted, they can see in real time how many Twitter shares it had,
yeah.
and how many Facebook shares it had, and how many people have viewed it, and how many people shared it with their friends. And yes, and basically in real time, they get paid for each of those for their, all those advertisements. So commercially, it's very much driven that way.
Yeah, for the income of the industry or whatever.
I think it's just an extension of the old ad, you know, old adage adage, if I can speak, if it bleeds, it leads. And it's the same kind of thing where you'll have these leading titles or headlines to get the clicks, and, you know, same idea. It's, you know, sensationalism.
Yeah. So some ways it's new, but in some ways it's the same kind of thing when people had newspapers and they come up with some large, outrageous headline to catch people's attention to try to get them sucked in to actually read the article. So it's just a new permutation of that.
Yeah, they've always been that way. I mean, they care about how many viewers they have because that's what the advertisers care about.
Right.
Whether they get advertisers, whether they get ones who are willing to pay them good money, comes down to how many viewers they have. This is really no different. Having said that, I think journalism is pretty much absent from the media these days. There used to be a lot of actual journalistic news going on.
Yeah.
I think it's pretty much absent from mainstream media. BuzzFeed is actually trying to pick up some real journalists.
Oh, is that right?
Actually go to places like Syria, go across the seas, you know, go to places where whatever's happening and actually report on it.
Right.
Instead of just, because you take a look at the mainstream media, it's all just opinion.
Oh, yeah, that's
it's,
right.
It's an op-ed after op-ed.
Yeah, it
by
is.
By people that are paid to provide those.
And I think that's because they've seen, like, favorite whipping post of Fox News. You know, they've seen that that format generates people watch it. And, you know, it's and it's stupid. Like, everyone knows Fox News is full of crap, but there's how many people that still watch it?
That reminds me, who's
all 50 plus.
Who has seen Anchorman 2 yet?
No.
Because that's basically the premise of Anchorman 2.
Oh.
Spoiler alert. Basically, they're in the 80s and they decide to start just, instead of trying to do responsible journalism and have sit down and have substantive interviews with important people, they would just start going around and live following car chases because people like watching car chases. Right. And it was like some grandma off her meds driving erratically. And that was the live news of the day. And that's, so they started this big trend on, this is the point of the movie, that it became very popular to go and chase these ratings. And then they were wildly popular. By the end, he decides that that's not really a good way to do journalism. So I thought it was, aside from being rather funny, I thought it did have a good little point.
Have a moral.
It sort of poked a finger at the very poor journalism that's going on. And I wouldn't say it's dead, but it's on a bit of life support, certainly.
Mm-hmm.
They have cut the actual journalists, actual reporters, mm-hmm. people that travel and go places where things are done, and instead just try to confuse you with a whole bunch of shiny, bright lights flashing all over the place on the screen and holograms and crazy things and people talking.
Cool graphics.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's kind of a catch-22 because, like, with the internet, I mean, the irony is we're recording a podcast, but this is part of what the issue is because everyone can flood the market with opinion and whatnot.
That's true.
You know, and I think that's where some of it is. It's evolved into that way, although there are things that are swinging back. Like, I'm a big fan of Vice, like Vice magazine. Like, just starting this year, they're setting up their own news bureaus in different places. And Vice is very no bullshit kind of news. Like, they will send their guys right in the middle of a firefight, like with a camera. And like, these guys are just, you know,
right.
You know, it's really interesting because they try to do it just blunt. This is the way it is. You know, there doesn't seem to be as much angle or spin on it as, say, if you're watching CNN or obviously Fox News. Like, it's very, here it is, like it or love, you know, like it or loathe it. I mean, I think there are elements of true journalism out there, but there's a lot of, it's just done for ratings and flash.
It's just clickbait.
Yeah. And then plus with the ease of the internet, there's a lot of, everyone can comment on anything, and that's seems to be feeding it, where it degenerates into, from a news story, into everyone's just random opinions. Facts mean nothing.
Yeah, that's right.
So you're saying we're part of the problem.
Ironically, sort of, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like a cartoon I saw one time, and I'm like, I thought it was true, is where this guy's standing at the front of a, you know, university class, and he's like, okay, you know, welcome to your first day of journalism school. And after 4 years and spending, you know, thousands of dollars, you're going to come out and have to compete with someone sitting in their basement. Yeah. You know, and yeah. It's this is fun, but ironically, this is part of the what the issue is because it still boils down to journalism. I think it's still out there. It's just not through your normal news sources anymore. Like, I mean, if someone is podcasting with integrity and, you know, wants to do actual journalism, you can still actually do it. It's just a lot easier to do it. You don't have to do it. You don't have to start as a cup reporter working for, you know.
Yeah, you can just make a podcast. You don't have to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Really? We should try that.
Well, we could talk about this TED Talk by Richard Wilkinson.
We could.
Economic disparity affects everything.
That's a really data-intensive talk.
It actually is, yeah.
You know, the best way to have that talk is to actually look at all the data. And the data is what he gives you
right.
in the TED Talk.
I thought it was interesting that even like all the, they had economic disparity and some countries were at the low end where everybody was pretty close to equal. And then the U.S. Yeah. was way up at the other end where everybody was so far apart. And Canada was kind of in the middle.
We're in the middle, yep. The Scandinavian countries, Japan, New Zealand, those are countries that were closer to, having a bit closer anyway.
Right.
Less of a gap between the classes. I suppose we should probably introduce what we're talking about in a sense. Wilkinson was talking about how all of this is related to better, like a lower incidence of psychological disorders, better literacy, lower rate of crime, lower death rate of children.
Yeah.
Like all of these different things that measure a country's well-being, the citizen's well-being, were correlated with a lower gap between the classes.
Yeah.
Whereas all the social problems were correlated with a higher gap
yeah.
between the classes. And the thing is, I mean, it's only correlation. But the data is, it's not like you have a sample size of 200. We're talking about census of entire countries
yeah.
full of millions of people. All of the data collected by those countries are put into this. So, I mean, it's not just a small sample size to represent a country. It's complete data.
Yeah, eh? Yeah, it's...
It probably takes a generation almost, or two, from when you change the tax laws, when you change the inheritance taxes, when you change the, you know, various things that determine how income is divvied up between the different types of people, before you really start seeing those full effects on people, on the next generation, on the baby's birth weights, on all of those things. So, you know, when people say, we can't fix that because that would mean taking massive amounts of money away from rich people and handing it to people who don't know how to handle money.
Redistribution.
Well, you didn't. That's redistribution. That's communism. Well, you didn't get into the problem overnight. Don't expect to solve it overnight. But if you start changing the policies, going back to policies that worked better and abandoning the policies that got you into the place where the income disparities have gotten so bad, then gradually things will even out better.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting that we live in a culture that figures hoarding of millions and millions of dollars is okay, as long as, you know, we don't redistribute to people who are starving to death.
Yeah.
You know, it's such a strange dichotomy to me. Like, it's just, we're okay with people living up on the fucking hill, fucking being rich. Mm-hmm. And we're okay with people starving in the street.
No. Yes, we are.
As long as we don't take it from the people on the hill.
It's okay if people are rich.
Yes.
But why are we okay with people exporting all of their money to you know, the Caymans and getting great big tax breaks on doing those sorts of things, like all of those loopholes,
yeah.
and the paying almost no tax on the income generated from all of that wealth, because it's capital gains, or you can pay some fancy accountant to make sure you never hardly have to pay any tax on that. You don't have to pay much of any inheritance taxes. Like, you know, as I have, my family has inherited some money. At some point, I'll probably inherit money. But I think it's one of the best ways to ensure that when people, young people start out in life, they've got more of an even shot at things. Instead of some people being, getting into universities on legacies and having enormous trust funds and being able to screw up their lives for 15 or 20 years and then finally get serious and straighten around. And
George Bush.
Like a George Bush.
Well, oh, I mean, that's happened in England too.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, this is not a new problem.
No.
That reminds me of something else Wilkinson talked about, which was that the social mobility in the United States was one of the worst social mobilities in the world. So if you want to live the American dream, move to New Zealand.
Yeah. There are places, I think, where you
which is ironic.
It is.
Yeah. I think there are places where the idea of lifting yourself up by your bootstraps can work. You have to have a society that is, that has those open doors. But the whole, you know, when people came up with the term bootstrap, it was as a mockery of the idea that you can lift yourself up.
Right.
Because if you actually have pull on bootstraps, you can't lift yourself up. You aren't going to go anywhere. You cannot make yourself airborne.
They don't know anything about physics.
Yeah. You might get yourself out of some mud, but that would be about it. The whole idea that you can lift yourself up without being in a supportive community, without being surrounded by, you know, teachers or friends or family or coworkers that give you a hand, that help you out, that, you know.
Yeah, reminds me of, you didn't make that, Obama, right?
Yeah.
Right. You didn't make that. Everybody helped you make that.
Yeah. Oh, do you know who did make that? Christy with the traffic jam. He built that. That's just a little derail. Sorry. I've seen so many good little people are that's just gold for people making political posters, because they just put his large self on the bridge blocking traffic and
right.
He built that. Anyways.
Well, he claims not. It was an underling that, and then he.
Okay, in an effort not to get sued, I'll say he's alleged to have built that.
Yes. Yeah. I don't know. I'm pretty sure. Pretty sure.
Can we get sued for telling the truth?
Yeah. Like you and me. We're,
yeah.
I think we have to be a little
fictitious
careful.
Internet people at this point.
If you guys get if. I'm pretty sure Jon Stewart's going to get hit with a lawsuit before you.
Yeah.
I was watching him last night the other night making fun of Christy, where it's like, you're from New Jersey. Come on. If you're going to be corrupt, be a little bit more sly about it. Did you take care of that thing? Yeah, I took care of that thing.
I'm not sure if there's anything else we should be saying about disparity. It's all about
we're
data.
Not in favor of it.
Yeah, well, that's right.
I don't know. I
anybody who thinks about it isn't right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. It's what I watched that video, and I'm sure I've seen it before.
Yeah.
And
it's been around for a while.
Yeah. The only thing is you know, there's with the American dream, blah blah blah. You know, there is such a gap, and yet it just seems like there, you know, this whole everyone seems to buy into it, like American exceptionalism and all this other kind of crap. Yeah. But it's never just a, you know. People don't want to pay taxes, you know, they don't want the rich to pay taxes because they seem to think that, well, I'm not rich now, but, you know.
Yeah, I will be soon.
I will be soon. You know, it's like.
Soon as I
who
make
was it. Was
it
that said Americans perceive themselves as temporarily embarrassed millionaires?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I've heard that one. I can't remember who said that. And it's just like, well, it's a stupid idea because, like, there's this finite amount of money. Like, mind you. With all the reality TV shows, everyone seems to be buying into it.
Yeah, that's still one in, 100 million?
Yeah.
Sorry, bro, you're not getting a TV show.
Teen Mom and all that
embarrassed
crap.
Millionaires like they
well,
all.
They, well, they are, because I've seen interviews where they're talking about paying taxes, because like there's a lot that do seem to think that, yeah, sure, I'm broke as hell now, but you know, when I get up there, I don't want to be paying those taxes. And it's like,
they seem to think that they're competing with other nations in that sense. You know, well, we're sending our labor, in a sense, across seas, right? We're getting all of our products made in China. You know, it's all because we're overtaxing. No, it isn't. It's because they work for pennies. And so then they start fighting for having no minimum wage. Well, but if only we had wage slaves right here at home, then we could attract all of the industry back here. Well, yeah, but then you'd have a bunch of people living like the people in China do.
Not to bring up my family too much, but my brother actually said, how many of those slave wage workers in China are taking that wage every night and going and drinking sake in the karaoke bar?
Zero.
Yeah, that's what I said. How can he even think like that?
They have subsistence wages. Well,
they do not have enough to eat.
He's in the wrong country.
Wow.
Yeah, wrong country. But, you know, like, I mean, that's just it. I've heard that argument, too. It's just like, Bangladesh that just had that massive fire in the shirt factory or whatever, a bunch of people died.
Okay, yeah.
And there is that argument, and I don't have an answer. I don't know which way to go. Is about the people. Is it better that, yeah, they're only making 2 cents an hour, or, you know, a dollar a day or whatever? Is it better that they are actually making that money or not making that? You know, it's better than nothing. And it's like, well, mm-hmm. No. Like, I mean,
they do choose that over their other options. On the other hand, if every other country had a sort of minimum wage that would discourage us from going and exploiting them, we might actually employ our own fucking citizens.
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
Wouldn't that be interesting?
Well, that's just like, you know, and like, and that's just it. It's like, it just seems, I mean, it's hard to have a minimum wage because each country has their own currency and it's kind of, you know, it's just like our minimum wage is awesome in comparison to the American minimum wage and, you know, cost of living and yada, yada, yada.
But Bangladesh is a good example of why you would want to have a minimum wage, because once labor is rather available and you've taken away those controls, basically, yeah, you have people who will work for 12, 16 hours a day just to get enough to put food in their own mouth.
Yeah.
And that is not the way that you want to run a country. And to have hundreds of people competing for a job that is just enough to put, you know, to maintain a somewhat malnourished life.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. I mean, I know there's the American idea of just let the free market reign and everything will be hunky-dory. But you look at, like, say, Bangladesh or even to a certain extent India, even though it's an emerging market and whatnot, there are sections of India where they're like, I think it was India where they show them stripping old ships of asbestos and stuff like that. And all they're wearing for protective gear is like bandanas over their face as they're handling asbestos with their bare hands.
There's no protection at all.
Processing medical waste or things like that.
And it's just, it's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah, it's how low are you willing to go in terms of the safety and wage and working conditions?
Yeah.
And it becomes a race to the bottom. Mm-hmm. And that is not the way that any country
should
wants
we really
to
be
operate.
Doing that? Should we
I
be racing
not.
To the bottom?
Well, it's a race to the bottom because it's the jobs that are scarce, not the labor.
Yeah.
Right? So, I mean, free market forces obviously push it to the bottom.
Yeah, it has to.
I mean, there are cases in which labor is scarce and the jobs are not. Those are really skilled jobs, right? Like doctors, perhaps.
Right.
In certain markets, sometimes the jobs aren't the scarce. But here we're talking, I mean, the vast majority of jobs, those are the scarce things. It's mm-hmm. people that are plentiful.
Yeah.
And you know, telling everybody, oh, you just need to go to college. Well, that's fine. But, okay, look at places, like, I know somebody from Tunisia. The government pays for everybody to get a college degree there. But yet there are not enough jobs for all of that. They had quite a big growth in population. So everybody has a degree. A lot of people have master's degrees and can't get work because they just delaying entering the workforce and going to school for that much longer. Yes, it helps you to compete against everybody else. But if there is not enough jobs for that population and not enough money to be buying and selling things within that country, nothing to export particularly, well, just education more doesn't actually help the situation much.
Yeah, the reality of the situation is that even a higher education doesn't do anything.
In a sense, not if everybody has it.
Yeah.
But that's not an argument against a higher education. No, that's
true. It's a higher educated.
It's good to have an education. Yeah. But when you have to have a degree to become a manager at McDonald's or something, where it is completely unnecessary to go into a massive amount of debt, and certainly it seems to be the case in the States, to go into a huge amount of debt in order to work in a job that really has no particular requirement to have that knowledge base, but it's just a way of separating you, the people with a degree, from the people with not a degree. Well, it's really unhealthy to have that kind of a labor situation where even that is going on.
I mean, in our own country, I would still argue for free education, though, right?
I'm not against good education. Everyone should have good education.
Yeah. You're talking like Norway, the Scandinavian countries, Germany, Switzerland. Yeah. There's all sorts of places that do very well with free education.
But not everybody is cut out for college, though. And I think it's a massive waste of money to say everyone must go to the typical kind of college where you sit there and write essays and things.
I am a terrible student. Though.
The natives here go to college for free, and they don't necessarily do anything with it. I mean, they take native studies and stuff. Mm. I think that's fine, though. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I mean, even writing essays, even if you're not going to do anything with it, like getting an arts degree, we joke, well, how useful is that? Mm-hmm. It's very useful. It's not what you can do with it. It's what it does with you. And but I think education is valuable for everyone.
Absolutely. Yeah,
but a lot of it, really, you've got the technical education, the SIAS type track, and then the off to university type track, and I don't think it's good to say, well, it's much better to go get a proper degree than to go and become a journeyman, something or other. Or
the world needs carpenters.
We all need those things. They all need to be done. And who's to say somebody with an English degree is more valuable than somebody who is a plumber or a mechanic? Like, everybody needs to have the ability to sort out for themselves what little direction that they want to take and not have enormous insurmountable money obstacles to getting there.
What the hell was I going to say? Shit.
You're going to make fun of me for being a philosopher.
I was totally going to make fun of you for being a philosopher. No, it's a running joke, though, isn't it? Like the philosophy degree is a degree that nobody values.
Well, I value the fuck out of it.
Of course you do, and like anybody who likes critical thinking, perhaps, values it.
Sure.
But it's not a carpentry.
In monetary value, it's difficult to put
the philosophy works at McDonald's.
Most degrees are kind of that way. I mean,
anthropology, for example.
Exactly.
A lot of the liberal arts degrees are that way.
How many students would not be graduating if I didn't edit their theses?
That's true. Yeah, absolutely.
There is that.
Well, I personally think that both of your educations are beyond valuable. Philosophy and anthropology and anything scientific.
I think all education is valuable.
Yeah.
I really do.
I mean, it's just a matter of, we seem to want a clear application of that. Like, you go in for an engineering degree. Well, I've got my engineering degree. I'm going to get my engineering job. Mm-hmm. I've got my medical or doctor, and I'm going to become a doctor, my doctorate or whatever.
Yeah.
But anything else other than that, it goes into fuzzy areas. You got your philosophy degree. Well, okay, you're a philosopher. Well, what does that mean?
how do you put a value on your philosophizing?
What's interesting, if you look at the data, philosophers generally end up making more money than a lot of the technical people with technical degrees, science degrees, on average.
Because they become professors?
I mean, it's a matter of...
Do all sorts
because
of things.
Getting PhDs, maybe, and then they end up in academia. Because really, you have to follow. You pretty much can't just get a bachelor's and call it good. Like, most people will stick with it and get a PhD and then end up, doing something with that, which is all fine and lovely. I have a master's degree in agriculture, actually. Well, so you could put me down on the list of rather applied sciencey kind of.
Agriculture is definitely applied, isn't it?
It's definitely an applied art.
Mm-hmm.
So when I was trying to decide what I wanted to do with myself, I'd rather had the idea that, well, my parents were not going to pay for me to go to school for 12 years, so I'd better get in and get out and get something that I could, support myself and whatnot. So yeah, that's what
I'm a sociology dropout, so.
Well, I guess that would make me an anthropology dropout.
Oh, right, right.
I got half my anthro degree, but, you know.
You got more than I do. Yeah,
so.
Very related there, sociology and anthro.
I gotta they are basically, sociology's obsessed with the Western views and cultures. Anthropology looks at everything else.
That's a good way of looking at it. The way I look at it is anthropology is reducible to sociology, which is reducible to psychology, which is reducible to biology, etc.
Right, right.
Which is reducible to agriculture.
I don't know.
I think we could get into all kinds of funny arguments about that.
I'm thinking biology and agriculture is kind of in the same area.
Same boat.
Same boat.
It's the same level.
Yeah. Same thing.
It's interesting.
Which is reducible to chemistry, which is physics.
Which is reducible to physics.
Yeah.
You got it.
Everything is physics.
Well, yeah. It's, kind of by it definition.
It kind of has to be, eh? Yeah. Without physics, there is no matter, in a sense.
Thank you, Sheldon.
We're not going to discuss physicalism in our podcast.
Okay.
Materialism or anything like that.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Good. We should move on. That's beyond my depth. I don't mind dabbling in some philosophy and ideas as a hobby, but I am no professional, so...
Well, that's it for part one. I'll try and have the other two parts up as soon as possible. Thanks for listening. If you like the show, feel free to contact us at brainstormpodcast@outlook.com, as well as on our Facebook and Twitter pages. If you subscribe on iTunes or Stitcher, please give us a rating and write a review. Or if you really like us, go ahead and donate. Just follow the donate buttons on our WordPress, brainstormpodcastblog.wordpress.com. Relevant links will be posted there as well. Thanks again for listening. Be sure to check out part two, where we tackle the Friendly Atheist's predictions for 2014.
And we're live. Hello from the audio engineer.
And suddenly everyone's like, collective IQ drops in nothing because we mentioned Sarah Palin.
Conversation killer.
Yeah. I don't think anybody's actually a professional, except Lawrence Krauss, of course.
Huh? In philosophy?
No, in physics.
Oh, in physics?
Yeah.
There's quite a few professionals.
I don't know. A lot of them seem to be kind of making it up as they go along.
Stephen Hawking seems to know what he's talking
about. Yeah, that's true. You can't really... Yeah, Stephen Hawking really seems to know what he's talking about.
Yeah, sort of. I mean, when he's just playing with language, he acknowledges that. When he owes a debt to philosophy, he acknowledges that.
Right.
You know, he's studied the history of thought. So... true intellectual.
We're getting very deep.
Yeah, well, we'll cut all this shit anyway.
Yeah. Just anything that makes me look stupid.
Well, he's the editor.
I only edit what makes me look stupid.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I've noticed.
Yep.
Yeah, fuck that.
Totally off topic now.
Yeah, we derailed.
That's all right.
That's all good.
Perchance to dream
or whatever. Too dumb to talk about.